All right, we are continuing with our series on Galatians. We're going to close out the series next week. How many remember that commercial, oh goodness, 10 years ago? They still show it today, where there's this poor old lady that's walking. Ow! I've fallen and I can't get up. Right, you know what I'm talking about? And then she hits the little pendant. Mrs. Jones, we're on our way. And it became like a comedian's, everyone started making fun of it. And everyone started saying, I've fallen and I can't get up. We joke about it, we laughed about it, and the lady made millions of dollars by falling and can't getting it up. And she hit the pennant, and all of a sudden, everyone comes, the world stops and picks her up, right? How many of you know people that have fallen, and they just can't get up? And they've asked God for help, they've pressed the button, no one's there to help them up. Truth of the matter is this, all of us are going to fall from time to time. I don't care who you are or what you are. If you're a human being, you're going to fall. You're going to make mistakes. What happens when you fall? How do you get back up? I have good news for you today. Jesus Christ wants to get you back up on your feet again. He's got good news, plans for hope, and plans for a future. And as a church today, we're going to look what the Bible has to say. How, when you've fallen, how do you get back up? And so if you want to turn to your Bibles, please, to Galatians chapter 6. We're going through Galatians. Now, let me just go back for a few moments to you. For those of you that have not been here through the whole series, let me back up a little bit and explain what this whole book's about, all right? Just briefly. The book of Galatians was written by the Apostle Paul about 50, anywhere from 30 to 50 A.D. It was written to the region of the world called Galatia. Modern-day Turkey is Galatia. And when he wrote to the Galatian church, he was writing to a region, not just to one church, but a region of churches. For example, today, someone wrote a church, I'm going to write a letter to the southern New England. I'm going to write to the churches of New Haven County, okay, to the churches of Hartford County or Oxford. And so they would hit different areas, and they would send letters, and then couriers would go and read it each church. And the Apostle Paul was dealing with some issues that they had. And by the way, the church had issues from its founding. You know why? Because the church is full of people, and people have issues that require tissues. Thank you. So we all have issues. And so the Apostle Paul, and one of the things they were dealing with in that day was this. There was the high church. They had tier systems back in those days. Martin Luther King Jr. said the most segregated hour on Sunday morning is church. I'm thankful to say that our church is not that way. But there was segregation in the church of that day because what happened was, just to help everyone, remind everyone, that Jesus was Jewish. I don't know if you realize that. Jesus was Jewish. The early church was Jewish. In fact, it wasn't called the church until later on in the book of Acts. There were a sect of Judaism. And so the church was Jewish. And they were the first ones. And listen, they had a hard time. They were getting beat up by the Romans and everyone else. Then, when they decided to follow Jesus Christ, now the Jews were against the Jewish people. So now you were persecuted by the Romans and persecuted by other Jewish people. And they stood strong, they carried the water, they did what they had to do. All of a sudden, through God's ways, the Gentiles, which are non-Jewish people, and you have to understand something, the Jewish people were taught to stay away from those dirty Gentiles. Don't touch them, they're dirty, they'll pollute you. So they've been taught that for millennia, right? All of a sudden, you have the situation now where the church is full of Gentiles, and they're growing. And all of a sudden, they start superseding the high church. You know, these Jewish Christians now, the Gentiles are greater in number, and they're taking areas of pride. Whoa, 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 whoa. You got to follow all these rules. And by the way, I'm not making this stuff up, but the major thing they talked about was circumcision. And so what would happen is if you joined the church, men, you'd have to be circumcised. Aren't you glad we don't have that today? No, you're not glad? Okay. So anyhow, and so they required people to do that, and they had to do all these festivals. And if you didn't do that, you weren't a good Christian. And so there was all this, like, you have to do this, this, and the other. The apostle goes, wait a minute here. Will you save by doing good things, or will you save what Jesus did on the cross? So that's what the basic premise of the book is. And so what it's all about is how to live in the freedom that God has given us every day. We've been speaking about that. In the very first week, we taught on a principle that was my first church I ever worked at. It was a principle I learned there. It's called living in the tree of life instead of living in the tree of knowledge of good and evil. I encourage you to go back. One of the most important messages in regards to how we live a relationship with God. Then we talked about a bunch of other things, how to crucify the old nature, that your sons and daughters in Christ. Now, today, I've fallen and I can't get up. How do we hit the pendant star? How do we get the help we're supposed to get? And so that's what we're talking about today. And I don't know if you know anyone like that. Maybe you've fallen. Maybe you've fallen in a broken marriage. Maybe you've fallen hard on the law. We knew a person that, again, when I use these examples, just no one in the church. So if you tell us something, we're not going to get up here and do it, okay? It's that the human condition is the same everywhere. But we knew a person, a good friend of our family, that they were involved, they're Christians, they went to church, and the gentleman was embezzling money over a five-year period of only $50,000 over a five-year period. He got caught. He got sent to prison. They lost their house. They lost everything. Their marriage was on the rocks. All that stuff was happening. And he was ashamed. Didn't want anyone to know what happened to your debt. And they moved to a different area. I don't want to tell you what happened to me. And so he was fallen. And I will say, to the benefit, the church really handled it well. His family was there to help him out. We were there to help him out. We said, we realize you've fallen, and we're going to help you get back on your feet. And we gave money to the person. We helped them out. We helped babysit. We did the whole thing and helped them walk out his shame so he could get back on his feet rather than whip him to a shred. You know, sometimes I've heard people say that sometimes a church shoots its wounded. When someone's down, it's easy to kick them. And sometimes you're afraid because you don't want anyone else to do this. I'm going to make an example of this person. Or perhaps maybe you struggle with various issues in your life. Maybe you have a problem with alcohol or drugs, or maybe you have a problem with infidelity, or whatever your issue can be. You've made a mistake, you've fallen, you're down, and you just don't know if you can get back up again. Well, the good news is that when you do fall, God wants to get you back up today. And Galatians is a book about experiencing victory in Christ. And the church's responsibility is to help those who fall down, to get them back up. It's not about knocking people down and hope they stay down so you feel better about yourself. And so today, let's go ahead and open our Bibles. And if you don't have your Bible, you can follow on the screen and read from the New King James Version and the New Living Translation today and different sections of the Bible today. We're going to start off with Galatians 6:1. Brethren, and when it says brethren, it means both men and women. Brethren, if a man, a woman or a man, is overtaken in a trespass. Trespass is they do bad things. They trespass on their marriage. They trespass in money. They trespass with alcohol or drugs. They trespass with gambling. They trespass with causing divisions. They trespass with pride. You name it, whatever you want to call. You who are spiritual, restore such in a spirit of gentleness. Those of you who are spiritual, those of you who think you're of Christ, restore such a person. It doesn't say kick them to a curb. It doesn't say put another round or a magazine in the gun and finish them off. It says restore the person that has fallen in a spirit of criticism. No, gentleness. We spoke last week about the fruits of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness is part of it. What does gentle mean? Well, ever pick up eggs? How are you supposed to pick up eggs? Gently, lest you break the egg, right? When someone's going through something like that, we should pick them up carefully. Why? Why? Well, this is the reason why. Considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. Well, I'm not tempted with that. That's not a problem for me. Yeah, that's true. Listen, if there was an 18-wheeler today that came to this church and filled this stage with alcohol up to here and put drugs and all kinds of drugs up here, I could sit here. I can honestly tell you it is not even close to a temptation. I want nothing. I mean, it never was a temptation for me. However, if you fill the parking lot with high-performance automobiles and pizza and Chipotle, I'm going to have a problem. Okay, that's temptation for me. So, you know, and so just because you're not bothered by something, realize you may not be tempted with X, but you might be tempted with Y. And so we got to be careful to that. And I want to bring it to your attention. I'm going to get a little controversial. I'm not afraid to get controversial. I've been here in this church a period of time. You know that's the case. And the reason why I'm not afraid to be controversial is because every time you turn the news on your electronic device or television or cable, whatever, or around the office cooler, there's a big thing now talking about genderless bathrooms, right? right? You hear about, oh, we need to have journalists. Can't go to North Carolina if you, you know. And so all this is going on. And it's very, very easy to get agitated and frustrated. How ridiculous is it? And get angry and start getting red in the face and have veins popping out of your neck while you're beginning to scream. This is insane. Until you step back and wait a minute. Let me stop for a second here. You know, all of us struggle with stuff. I thank God that it's not a struggle that I have. I don't struggle with my sexual identity. But I've known people and know people that do. And you know what? What would happen if that was your struggle? What would happen if that was the unwanted passenger in your life? How well would the church take care of that person? Truth is, that person is made in the image of God. Truth is, God loves that person. So what are we to do with people that struggle with that? Do we make provisions? And no, I think we need to be wise with that. But before we get into all the legality of it, what's your attitude towards someone like that? You know, I want the church to be a place where someone is struggling with that area, they can come through a church and know they're not going to be kicked to the curb. They're going to be loved and say, listen, I don't struggle with that issue, but, you know, I struggle with certain issues. And so I want to help you. I want to let you know you're full of value and there's a better way for you. And that's the way the church, not to say, hey, it's okay, come on in, I'm okay, you're okay, it's all right. Do what you want and I'll do what I want. We all love Jesus. It's grace, 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 grace. All I need is grace. Don't you love his face? Come on, come in the church. No, we're not suggesting that. But what we are saying is that all of us has fallen short of the glory of God. There's not one that is right, no, not one. And so when you encounter people with issues you don't struggle with, you don't just throw them, you got other issues in your life you're struggling with, and if you don't think you're struggling with any issues, you're perhaps the most convoluted and deluded person in the world, because all of us have issues we're working with. All of us have issues, as Doris has reminded us, that require tissues. And so there are people that struggle with various things. So what we want to do is create a place. When you've fallen and you can't get up, you're going to have somebody that wants to help you get up, back on your feet, get on the right path, strengthen feeble knees, and help you walk a path that you've been called to. And I just want to say that this is an area that we're hearing about constantly in our media. And we have to respond in the right capacity. We don't respond in saying, ah! Nor do we respond, hey, it's okay. And we respond, you know, this person needs help. They're broken like I'm broken. And we want to be a blessing to them. Know that Jesus is the answer for any ailment that you have, any difficulty you have. We believe that Christ is the answer. And so the Bible says, as we look in the scriptures here, we are looking here in Galatians 6, verse 1. Brethren, as a man has taken overtaken, but any trespass... You who are spiritual, those who are mature, are to restore such one in the spirit of gentleness, considering in yourself, lest you be tempted. Number two, verse two, bear one another's burdens so to fulfill the law of Christ. What's bearing someone's burdens? Well, imagine, for if you will, if someone's carrying a heavy load on their back. And they're trying to carry it up the stairs. And what you would do is you would get down with them right alongside. Hey, I see what you're going through. I want to help you through this. You get under the load, and you would help pick that up. And I've been very gracious and very thankful that when we've moved in the past, we've had people in the church help us move. And so you get a bunch of guys and gals, you know, all taking the burden together, it's a lot easier. It's a lot lighter, isn't it? And so the Bible's saying is to get down, to will to be associate with someone that's going through a hard time, will to be associate with someone that struggles with their sexual identity, will to associate with someone that has substance abuse problems, marital problems, anger problems, you name it, and get down with them and commune with them, say, I'm taking the burden on myself, so they can carry that load. Even Simon carried Jesus' cross. Even Jesus couldn't bear his own cross. There are times in your life where you're not able to bear your own cross, and we should be helping each other out and encouraging each other in a non-judgmental capacity. We're going to balance this out before we leave here today, I promise you. But it says, bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law. What? What's the law? Well, I'll tell you what the law is. The law is found in John 13, 34. Jesus said, I'm giving you a new commandment. Love one another just as I've loved you. You should love one another. What does that mean, love? Well, it means agape. I mean, agape love means love without strings. It's not this political favors. If I support your campaign, then if I do this for you, you're going to help me with this. Since I've scratched your back, you're going to scratch mine. And by golly, if you don't scratch my back, you're in trouble. It's like going into a clothing store, which, as you can tell, I'm very dapper. I've gone to these clothing stores where the guys are on, like, they're like on commission, and it's like bees on honey. Can I help you, sir? And it's just like, it's not, leave me alone. Let me look at my own. I don't want to, you put all these clothes in front of me. Get away from me, you know. That's why I go into Costco. It's just a big warehouse. You wear it for a year and you bring it back. No, I'm just kidding. I don't do that. This is all Costco. No, it's not. Okay. But you know what I'm talking about, and there's people that actually help you in Costco or even the Apple store. They don't have any commission. Whether they sell it or not doesn't mean anything. They literally want to help you. Isn't that a difference, folks, right? What happens when someone actually wants to help you and they're not looking for anything else in return? You know what that's called? Refreshing. Because the whole world is out to get something out of you by giving you something. Now you owe me. What would happen if we gave without trying to receive back? We gave respect and honor and graciousness to other people and not waiting for them to come back to us. No dividends. I'm going to, no strings attached. And the Bible says here, bear one another's burdens. And it says here, the law of love. You know what love is? Love keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not expect anything. It just gives and gives and gives. There's another side to this. Don't worry. We'll get the balance, counterbalance of this. But the spirit of giving. Bear one another's burdens. And the only way you can bear someone's burden is to get down at their level and help them carry the load, to identify with the load they are carrying. Not, oh, God bless you. You just put on praise and put on K-Love and just come to church. God bless you. I'll be praying for you. Goodbye. We're not talking about that. And by the way, there are people out there that, I've tried this and so have you. There are people out there that are black holes. Okay? These people that are black holes, that means no matter how much you help them, they never change. And they're the ones that scream the most. They're the ones that say, help me, help me. And so you get alongside of them. You try to help them with the load. And then they walk away. And you're like, goodness gracious, what'd you do to me, right? And after doing that 3 or 4 times, you're like, you know what? I don't have time for that. And that's really unfortunate because there's a lot of people out there that really need help. So this is what I've learned to do. I'm giving you a little secret that I learned the hard way. When someone does that to me once or twice, I'm like, you know what? If someone comes to my office, I give them homework. They don't do the homework, I don't have time for you. If you really want to get help, I'll help you. And so now I've looked around and I find there's people that are really want help, but they're afraid to say they need help. And so we try to do is eagle eye and look for people that need help. And when we find a person that really needs help and they're going to take the help, we help them get back up. You follow me? The other people I say, hey, when you're ready, call me. But right now I don't have time to waste my time. And you're going to suck the life out of me so I can't help somebody else. So that's what, let me just tell you, I'll give you a little bit, because some of you have tried. I helped this person out, and it was a nightmare. I understand that. The enemy would try to get you discouraged in that, but there are people out there that have fallen, and if you'll get alongside of them, watch their world change and watch how you'll be blessed, I guarantee you. Bear one another's burdens. And by the way, there are people that will betray you after you help them. It happened to Jesus. It will happen to us. I'd rather err on the side of generosity and grace than the side of judgmentalism. And so it's wonderful to help someone who has fallen into sin get back in a right relationship with God. You know, I've seen a lot of great men and women have fallen. I've seen great preachers that I really respect, ministry leaders and musicians that I really looked up to have fallen. And it's like, gosh, I can't believe they've fallen. And the next thing you know, they get married, they throw their spouse away, they get another one, they're back on television, they're back writing books. Hey, I got a new one now. And it's like, wait a minute, you're in your third, you're a minister, what's going on here? And you're like, what's going on? Well, it's all about God's grace, bro. It's all grace, man. It's grace, brother. It's all about grace. He forgives me, he forgives you. There's no standards, and that's malpractice in grace. And so when I see someone fall, you know what it does? It makes me humble. And it sober minds me because I realize that this person could do that. I could do it as well. It says in verse 2 of Galatians 6, bear one another's burdens and so to fulfill the law of Christ. What's the law of Christ? Jesus said, love one another just as I loved you. You should love one another. Listen to this. Your love for one another will prove to the world that you are my disciples. Now, let me tell you something that's very interesting here. This is what I've learned. And you know how we can become a better church, greater church? And it sounds a little bit selfish, but it's not. If you and I will learn to love each other greater, we'll make a more of an impact on the world. Oh, that sounds... Now, I'm not talking about an ingrown toenail love, where it's all like sappy. You know, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about really loving each other, looking out for each other. And you've all... I hate to use this illustration, but I can't think of a better one. When you're on an airplane, what happens? The person says, if you lose cabin pressure, which you pray to God never happens, it's never happened yet, this mask will drop, and all of a sudden your heart's going like this. First, put it on yourself before you put it on the children. At first glance, it sounds really selfish, but it's wise. Because if you're not healthy, you can't help anyone else. And so for our church to be more healthy, the greatest mission we can do, how we can impact the world and impact our communities greater than anything we've done in the past, starts with us loving each other well. In fact, in a marriage, the best thing, parents, you can do for your kids is to love your spouse. My mom and dad were married. My dad was a pastor. My dad was, I'm going to just use his own words, he was clueless. He was working. And my mother fell out of love with him, and she said, I don't want to be married to you anymore. He's like, what? What happened? And he was clueless. So, guys, you know, sometimes we can be that way, right? And what had to happen? They had to get back, and their marriage is great now. But they were blind. He was blinded to the fact that their marriage was going the wrong direction. And some of you are blinded to that. And so basically the whole thing about this is to love one another to fulfill the word of Christ. Love your neighbor as yourself. And so this is all part of the process of helping each other out, to help each other out when we're falling. And the greatest thing you can do in a marriage, by the way, is to love your spouse. You want to help your children. Don't put the children first. Put your spouse first, and then your child will be secure. We've seen it through the years. I put my children before my spouse. Well, if that's the case, your marriage is not going to work very well. Once the kids leave, you're done. But if a husband and wife have a good marriage, that love relationship basically spreads onto the children. Now, I'm not suggesting you hire a nanny and travel the world in seven seas. I'm not suggesting, don't misunderstand me. But if your marriage is strong, your family will be strong. If the church is strong, we have a greater impact. Why? Well, Jesus said it right here. He says, just as I've loved you, your love for one another will prove to the world you're my disciples. I mean, when people come into a church and they sense that you are not trying to get something out of them, but you just want to bless them with no strings attached, it's foreign. It's like, what? There's got to be a catch. There's got to be. This is, and you know what happens? We should be looking around for other people we can bless. Why? Because that's the Spirit of Christ. And when you have the Spirit of Christ in you, more of Christ comes in you. And when more of Christ comes in you, more of His presence, the more fulfilled you are. Because you start becoming the person that God has designed you to become and who to be. So that's a commandment. Love one another. And love is difficult. It is. But its benefits are amazing. In Galatians 6, 1 again, it says this. It says, brethren, if a man or woman is taken in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such in the spirit of gentleness, considering yourself, lest you be tempted. I grew up in the church, and there was this gentleman that, not a gentleman, now he's a gentleman, another teenager, a couple years older than me. I'll just call his name Jack. It's not his name, but his name is Jack. And Jack's dad ran out on his mother. And he did the whole, he bought the Corvette. He got the chains around his neck with the hairy chest. You know, played the Bee Gees. You know, the whole sick disco era, you know, had the dice around the mirror, you know. That was the era back in those days with the weak Corvette. Anyhow, so he had the Corvette, and he left his family. He was an alcoholic. He drank a lot, and this poor woman had to raise her three children, did an amazing job. But this guy, Jack, was pretty jacked up because his dad did that. He says, I want nothing to do with my dad. I hate my father. He's an alcoholic. Well, I go to college, I come back, and lo and behold, he's way out of college now. Dropped out of college. Guess what his problem was? Alcohol. Guess what he acted like an alcoholic himself. Why? Because he was judging his dad. You know, I've seen it happen time and time and time again. Now, what do you mean? Why does it have to happen that way? I'll tell you what happens. I've seen this as well. I've seen a marriage dissolve because of infidelity. And I've seen, my wife and I, we've experienced this through the years with people we've known, and this poor person, the spouse did that, and they brought the spouse back. It's okay, I'll go for round two because we got the kids, and, you know, we'll keep it going. And, but they always reminded that person, hey, you know what you did, you know what you did, and constantly reminding the person of what they've done, putting it in their face, constantly bringing the excrement of their failure before their nose on a daily basis. And you know what happened to the person that never could forgive their spouse? Guess what they did 10 years later? They cheated on their spouse. Why? Why does this happen? Well, let me tell you something about heaven. The Bible says, judge not lest you be judged. The Bible also says in the scriptures that are provided for you, it says, as you judge others, you will be judged. It says in Galatians 6:7, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever man sows, that he will also reap. Remember, folks, what you do, if you bring judgment on someone, God says, do not judge lest you be judged. By the standard of measure you use, it will be used against you. So if you're out there like, and you know, if you got a husband and a wife going, it's like a cockfight. How would I know what a cockfight is? I went last night and won $100. No, I'm just kidding. I've never been to a cockfight, okay? But from what I understand, they just peck each other to death, and some of you do that to each other. It's not about doing that. I mean, what good does it do? It's like taking a bat and hitting yourself over the head. The Bible says that two shall become one flesh. Why not look for something that's proactive instead of destructive? And so the Bible says, it says to consider yourself and build each other up. Bear one another's burdens so to fulfill the law of Christ. And that's all part of the process, is to love your neighbor as yourself. And the whole process is to find a place of healing in your relationship. And how does that happen? Well, you realize, I'm going to try to help this person out. I'm not going to try to extract. I'm going to try to help this person. And we'll share with you in a few moments the balance of that, how that are supposed to work. So Jesus gave his command. And in Galatians 6:3, it says, if anyone thinks of himself to be something when he's nothing, he deceives himself. It says in Romans 12:3, don't think you're better than you really are, but be honest in your evaluation of yourself, measuring yourself by the faith God has given us. So it's easy to compare ourselves to other people. Once we start comparing ourselves to other people, there's three things that happen. Either you get a big head because I'm better than them, or you feel like I can never do what they do. I can't look as good as they do. I can't love God. I can't pray. I can't do. And it's all about that. It's not about measuring yourself upon someone else. You measure yourself upon Christ. God is not going to judge you how you ran my race. God's going to judge you how you ran yours. Isn't that good news? I think it's wonderful news. Be the best you can be. Don't be somebody else, because you're always going to be a facsimile and never be an original. God has made you a beautiful original. Why not become that person? And so the Apostle Paul also says that we need to soberly view ourselves. And in Galatians 6:14 says this, but God forbid that I should boast except the cross of Christ, by whom the world has been crucified to me, and I to the world. That's all the process God has given. And so we're called to bear one another's burdens. Why? Well, I'll tell you the reason why. We just talked about it. Verse 7, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. The enemy would sit there like this. Hey, I want to get involved with his life. You know, he's really judgmental about his father drinking. So, God, I want permission to meddle in Jack's life. Well, he hasn't forgiven his father, and so, okay, you have a certain amount of liability. He has some liability. You can go ahead and mess him in that area. So when you and I have a judgmental spirit, you know what it does? It opens us up to be attacked by the enemy. Because God will go, okay, you're going to be judgmental. As you sow, you will reap. So if you sow grace and forgiveness, you're going to receive that back. So how do we see it change in our lives? All right, here's some steps. How to restore someone. How do you restore somebody when someone has fallen? And by the way, if you're in this church, people are going to fall. Doesn't mean we make excuses. Oh, I'm going to fall. You're going to fall. We all fall down. Ashes. No, we're not talking about some sadistic nursery rhyme that I never taught my kids. What kind of nursery rhyme is that? Ashes, ashes, we all fall. It sounds like a nuclear warhead went off. It's terrible. I know, that's a little side note. I'm still getting over that in counseling, at those nursery rhymes when I grew up. So sadistic, Hansel and Gretel, this woman's going to eat me. Oh, okay. Anyhow, what does it have to do with the sermon? Nothing at all. Sponsored by Ritalin. Okay, let's move forward. How to restore someone. How would you want to be restored if you did what this person did? If you did what this person would do, how would you want to be restored? Well, I would never do that. Well, okay. You're so Mr. and Mrs. Perfect. But let's just suppose in your wild imagination that you did that. How would you want to be restored? Jesus said this, do unto others as you would do unto, as you want them to do unto you. It's called the golden rule, right? That's what we've coined a phrase in Matthew 7:12. How would you want to be restored if you're the one that made a mistake? In Matthew 7, you want to turn there. We're going to spend a few moments here in Matthew 7, verses 1. It says this, do not judge others, and you will not be judged. Now, this has been something that's now happened. Hey, man, don't judge. Don't judge, lest you be judged. Go ahead. You go ahead and do what you want to do. You want to go ahead and shrunk heads? You go ahead and do that. I won't judge you. It's okay. And that's not right. But let's continue to read it. People often quote a scripture, and they don't read the whole context. And so what does the Bible say? Do not judge others, and you will not be judged. For you will be treated as you treat others. In other words, how you exercise so-called justice to somebody else, you will be treated the same. You see that? The law of reciprocity, which is sowing and reaping. What you feed leads, right? What the seed you, if you sow corn, you're going to get corn back, not grapefruits. All right? So, do not judge others, and you will not be judged, for you will be treated as you treat others. The standard which you are judging is the standard by which you'll be judged. And why worry about the speck in your friend's eye when you have Noah's ark in your own? I'm sorry. When you have a log in your own. You know, this is what I have found. I have found that when I used to drive a Volkswagen Jetta, I saw a lot of Jettas because I was in the Jetta. And sometimes if you're struggling with a pride issue, you'll see everyone else that's struggling with pride. Why? Because you want to have pride. No, you may not see the same car, but you'll notice the same thing. The Bible says, first, take the log out of your own. And you, before you and I get on the judge bench and put the black robe on and have the gavel, and this court is in the session, before we become Judge Judy, okay, what we need to do is we need to go back and look at ourselves. Say, Father, is there anything in me that's prideful? Am I doing anything like that? Look and ask before you start. Before you go off on a tangent, just look at yourself first. Do not judge others. And says the, and why worry about the speck in your friend's eye? Excuse me. When you have a log in your own eye, how can you think of saying to your friend, let me help you get rid of that speck in your eye, when you can't see past the log in your own eye? You see what sin does? When you do wrong things, it blinds you. What we should do is go before God. God, search me, know me, try me. Is there anything that I'm not doing that's good, God, that's going to inhibit the grace and the love that you want to give me? And so, and what does it say? It says here, verse 4, how can you think of saying to your friend, let me get rid of that speck in your eye? Notice it says friend. You notice that? Yeah. When you can't see past the log in your own eye, hypocrite, this is Jesus saying that. First, get rid of the log in your own eye and let them be by themselves. Doesn't say that, does it? That's what people read us all the time. They don't read the rest of it. Then you will see well enough to deal with the speck in your friend's eye. So the Bible's not saying don't judge each other. It's saying first look at yourself. First, deal with your issues. Before you get into someone's business, look at your own business and be humble, realizing if not for God's grace, you could not stand other. And so that's the first thing we got to do. How would you want to be treated? Number one. Number two is first examine your own life. Look for areas not surrendered. Perhaps they're similar to somebody else's. You know what I have found? Often I'm irritated with somebody. I can't believe they think they're so hot. And I think to myself, well, gee whiz, I guess I'm kind of jealous because they're getting the accolades and I'm not. So I guess I'm accusing them of being what I want to be. Ooh. Okay. Number three, judge by the fruit so you can help. Wait a minute. You said not to judge. I understand that. Well, the Bible said first get the log out of your eye to get the speck. Now, what the Bible has to say in the same chapter, folks, do you realize judge not lest you be judged? People quote that all the time, even if they're not Christians. But if you read the rest of the chapter in which the context of that verse is found, you will see a full picture of proper helping each other out. Matthew 7:20 says this, yes, just as you can identify a tree by its fruit, so you can identify people by their actions. Yes, actions do speak. Matthew 16 is the chapter 7. So you can identify them by their fruit, that is, by the way they act. Can you pick grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? A good tree produces good fruit, and a bad tree produces bad fruit. A good tree cannot produce bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot produce good fruit. So every tree that does not produce good fruit is chopped down and thrown into the fire. Yes, just as you can identify a tree by its fruit, so you can identify people by their actions. Now, do you see that? Do you see the context here? If you take this about the fruit thing, you'd be real judgmental. But if you take the whole chapter of verse 7, and Jesus has one dialogue, by the way, this is not two different sermons. It's one sermon. He's basically saying, first, before you judge, deal with yourself. All right? Deal with your own junk. Then, when your heart is right, now you can deal with somebody else. My friends, we're not good at doing that. I'm not good at doing that. This is counterproductive. No, it's very productive. It's counterintuitive. You're saying it's counterproductive. I understand. You tried. Okay. And finally, there are steps of restoration. And my friends, if we would follow the steps of restoration, it would solve most problems in businesses, in families, in churches. And it's the following. It's found in Matthew 18. I know if you've been in the church a while, you've heard us already. Matthew 18, steps to restoration. Very, very clear. I'm going to go ahead and read it to you. This is Jesus telling Peter how to handle the situation. Okay? Verse 15. If another believer sins against you, go tell the pastor and put it on Facebook. Instagram. Okay. If another believer sins against you, go privately. You know what I mean? You know what privately means? Don't tell anyone else. Yeah, but they never listen to me. I tried. No, listen, I don't want to hear that. Have the courage. Remember last week we spoke about this. If you want to change, you got to own it before you give it away. Well, own your own offense and don't be running. Well, I mean, listen, I've done it too. It's easier for me to go over to Jessica. Can you believe what Jack has done? If your name is Jack, it has nothing to do with you. I don't even know Jack. Okay. So if I, Jessica, you know, can you believe what Jack did? Well, she should say to me, well, Pastor, have you spoke to Jack? Well, no, he doesn't listen. You know, Pastor, with due respect, you know, I know I'm an assistant pastor, but, you know, don't we have a rule at Cornerstone Church that we go to the person first? How dare you challenge? No. And then Chad comes. Don't you talk to my, no, that's not going to happen. He's taller and bigger than me, okay? But I am Italian. So, so anyhow, what would happen is I'd say, thank you, Jesse, you're right. And then I would need to go to Jack by myself, right? What the Bible says here? If another believer sins against you, go privately. We don't do that. Do you realize that most conflicts and difficulties and sins would be solved if we would go privately? Go privately and point out the offense or the difficulty. If the other person listens and confesses it, you've won that person back. The Bible says faithful are the wounds of a friend, but the kisses of the enemy are profuse. In other words, if you really love somebody, sometimes you got to tell them stuff they don't want to hear. But first, humble yourself. Deal with your own junk in your own trunk before you open someone else's trunk. And go there humbly, realizing if not by God's grace, you couldn't do a thing either. Okay, go to privately. Take ownership. Be a man. Be a real woman. And go to that person and be an adult. Don't be a little jellyfish person. Can you believe what they're telling me this? I mean, you know how many times I deal with that in the church? Really, it does it all the time. I got so angry at people doing that, then I did it. If the other person listens and confesses it, you've won that person back. But if you're unsuccessful, take the whole church. No. Take one or two others without putting it on Facebook. Or this is even worse. Putting something that's not direct but indirect. And someone can ask, are they talking about me or not? You ever see that happen? Then we have the audacity to put down what they want to say in Facebook. But they'll say something that, I think he's talking about that person. Just get off Facebook, get off Twitter, and stop being a twit. And go get two other people that care and go to that person. Listen, we're really concerned. We noticed that you are spending a lot of money and, you know, you're not being very fiscal to your family. Your spouse is really complaining, your kids. We want to help you out, my friend. We just love you. Or we know, we've done it. We have interventions with people that were on drugs and we've helped them out because we cared. We went to them privately, did the whole thing, and now they're doing well and living great because we did it in the right way. As it says here, when you're unsuccessful, take one or two others with you and go back again so that everything you say may be confirmed by two or three witnesses. If the person still refuses to listen, take your case to the assistant pastor, Jessica, and leave Pastor Eric alone. I'm sorry, it doesn't say that. Then he or she won't accept, if he or she will not accept the church, bring it to the church. There comes a point saying, listen, this person in the church has done this to me. Bada, bada, bada. I tried this. I did all that. They come to me. Okay, then we come to the church and say, listen, bro or sister, what you've done is wrong. It's destructive. And because we love you and we care about you and we've checked ourselves out, we're gonna have to ask you to step down or take a break, or you need to change yours, or we're going to have to say you're not allowed to be a part of this fellowship anymore. You can come, but you can't be involved until you deal with this issue because we care enough about you to say something, right? Then if he or she won't accept the church's decision, treat that person as a pagan or a tax collector. It means have nothing to do with them. Divine splitting. I tell you the truth, whatever you forbid on earth will be forbidden in heaven. God will see it. And whatever you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven. Verse 19, I tell you this, if two or three on here on earth agree on anything you ask, my Father in heaven will do it. So God will be in the middle of your situation. For when there are two or three gathered in my followers, I am there. Now, listen to this. I love this. Peter's like, oh, cool. All right, this is great, Jesus. Then Peter comes again. I thank God for Peter. He asked the question we all want to ask but are afraid to ask. Then Peter comes to him and asks him, Lord, how often should I forgive someone who sins against me? Seven times? In Judaism, three times was like, whoa, you are a stud of forgiveness. Three times. He says, no, not seven times. 70 times seven. Do you see the context with this? Look at chapter 7. And then look at chapter 6 of Galatians. Put the two together, you got a good antidote to bring restoration to somebody. Folks, it's God's desire to bring restoration. I'd rather bend on the area of grace and restoration than constantly think that everyone's out to get me, everyone else. Why not think the best of each other and expect the best? And when you deal with issues, let's do it together. Listen, I am thoroughly convinced God has called me, I believe, to pastor a church with this kind of understanding about restoration. This should be a place where anyone can come, no matter what they've done, no matter their baggage, no matter their background. We're going to treat them with love and respect, and we're going to respect them enough to challenge them to change for their own good. If we do that, you're going to grow, I'm going to grow, we're all going to be better people because of it. I tell you right now. So, as we conclude with the same verse we started off with. Brethren, if a man or woman is overtaken by any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such one in a spirit of gentleness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. Bear one another's burdens and fulfill the law of Christ. Help, I've fallen and I can't get up. We want to help you get up. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I recognize that today, Father, that this has been a difficult word in many ways because we're not mincing from the truth. But, Father, sometimes you have to break the bones to reset it. And Lord, I just pray for anyone here. I just believe there's a few people perhaps watching online or even here today that you're struggling with certain issues. And you're struggling with the issue I talked about, sexual identity. I just want to encourage you right now. I'll let you know something, that God loves you. You're not a mistake. We don't hate you. God loves you. We want to let you know there's a place for you here to help you to become the person that God's called you to become. There's a better way for you today. If anyone's struggling with that today, I want to let you know that this church is going to love you and accept you, who you are, and help you to become what God has designed you to be. And so, Father, we just pray right now for anyone that's struggling with various issues, whether it be marital issues, substance abuse issues, pride issues, lust issues, integrity issues, anger issues, pride issues. Father, we just lay them beside you right now. And, Father, we recognize that all of us have fallen short of your glorious standard. There's not one of us that's right without you. In Jesus' name. With every head bowed, I do this every single week because it's the most important question. I'm going to ask you a question today. How are you with Jesus? I might even ask you how you're doing in church. I don't care about church. I don't care about how long you've gone to church. Not about that. Jesus said, I'm the way, I'm the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father through me. How are you with Jesus? If you were to die today, God forbid, if you were to die today and you would say, God would say, why should I let you into church? Well, heaven, excuse me. Oh, because I'm a pretty good person. I went to church. I helped the Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts, and I did this and the other. And God's going to say, I don't know who you are. The only way you can go before God is through Jesus Christ, because Jesus paid the debt that no human being will ever be able to pay. You'll never be able to be good enough and do good enough deeds. Only what Jesus did on the cross is enough. He paid trillions of dollars for a debt and billions you can't even pay. And so if you will accept him today and believe he took away your sins and say, Lord, Jesus, forgive me my sins. If you'll do that today and hand your life over to him, stop trying to beat yourself, then today can be your day of salvation for you, my friends, where you can have confidence knowing that you are with God. So I'm going to pray a prayer right now. If you'll pray this prayer from the bottom of your heart and mean it with your heart, today can be a new day for you. I'm going to go ahead and pray. You want to pray quietly in your own heart. Lord Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God. I believe you died on the cross and paid for all of my wrongs, all of my sins. I accept your forgiveness. I thank you that you love me. And I thank you because I confessed my wrongs to you. It's now taken from me. I thank you right now. I give you my life. I say that no longer is it my life. I completely take my hands off my life and I place them in your hands. I will do whatever you ask me to do. I ask you to help me to walk this path before me. And through your power and through your help, with your help, I will walk this way for the rest of my life. In Jesus' name, every head bowed. I'm going to ask you something. The Bible says, if you will confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. I'm going to ask you on the count of three. Say, Pastor, I prayed that prayer today. I'm going to ask you real quick. The count of three. One, two, three. Just lift your hand real quick and say, Pastor, it's me. Thank you. Anyone else? Thank you. Thank you. I see two. Thank you. Come on, there's a few others. I just sense there's a few others of you. Thank you. Anyone else? Say, Pastor, it's me. I need to get right. There's five or six or seven of you right now. And for you watching online right now, you can go on a connection card as well. Listen, this is what we want to do. And the other side of the connection card, it says, he has your name. The other side says, I prayed that prayer today. I want to ask you to take to check that box. We're going to ask the prayer team to come up. And if you would like to, you need to share with someone else what you did today. We want to help you. Listen, we're on this path together, folks. Next week, I want to invite you to lunch. We're going to have something called Connection to God. Right after the second service, we're going to have a class just for you in particular. Right after the second service, 12:30. I want to encourage you to come to that. Let's all stand. We could. I want to pray for the rest of us right now. Some of you are walking around with condemnation and guilt. Some of you are walking around hiding from your sins. I want to let you know today that God is here to rescue you, not to condemn you. He's here to help you, not to bring you down. And so here at this church, we want to encourage you with that. So let's pray right now. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, we turn away from what we know is wrong. Father, I pray for Cornerstone Church. It would be a place that we lift each other up, that we love each other, that we encourage each other, Father God, that we help each other when we've fallen. We help each other get up. We don't judge, but we help. We correct in love. And Father, as a result of being together, I pray that all of us would become better people because of what you've done in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. I want to encourage you to come to class today. We have a few extra spaces, 12:30, right up next door. how to get connected to Cornerstone. Okay, everybody? God bless you. God bless you today. Please, if you fill these cards out and you made that check today, please hand it into one of the boxes, guys, or come up front. God bless you guys. We'll see you next week or see you. Thank you.